Now, with high-def printing, the quality of the prints is going to be identical. Mm-hmm. But there would be prints, once, let's say, The Exorcist went mass market, mm-hmm. I couldn't control those prints. There might be a print that was sent to, let's say, a small town in the Midwest that would look terrible, you know? And occasionally I would be in some town or in the States or abroad and see a print of the picture that was appalling because you could not control the quality of 35 millimeter printing.
Do you have a handle on the negatives or the where the most recent print is of all of your films? Or
not all, no. Yeah, but there are vaults around this country. Most of them are in Kansas City. But sometimes there are studio prints that are occasionally kept in their vaults in Hollywood.
But like I was at Roger Ebert's Film Festival in Champaign-Urbana, and he wanted to show three women. And the only print that existed before they made one for a Blu-ray, they finally decided to do a Blu-ray of the movie, was in such incredibly bad shape. And they sent him what was the new Blu-ray print, but it ended up, half of it got there and half of it didn't. So they had to give him the old print they had in the vault. And the color difference, color was completely washed out on the old print, which was 25 years old at that point. And then the new print looked great. But
you know what happened to
brutal.
The Godfather when Warner Brothers decided, I'm sorry, Paramount decided a couple of years ago or less, they wanted to put out a Blu-ray of The Godfather. Mm-hmm. They went into the vaults, and this is, of course, the crown jewel of Paramount, The Godfather. And they went into the vault, and the print had completely faded, the negative. All of those deep, rich blacks that you saw in the original print. It was the last of the three-strip printing that Technicolor did. Then they sold all the machines to China in favor of one-strip printing. But the Godfather negative had faded. All of the rich blacks, black as my T-shirt, had faded to milk. And they had to spend over $1 million to get this guy, Ron Haver, who was a restoration expert. And he took God knows how long, how many months, and over $1 million to restore the negative of The Godfather so that it could be reproduced as a Blu-ray. And this supposedly, they would know exactly the condition of the negative. But the studios, with the possible exception of Warner Brothers, really don't give a damn about their legacy. It's old movies. They want to sell you a new movie. It's why a place like the L.A. County Museum, which is trying to reorganize its film program, doesn't get a lot of help from the studios.
Right.
They don't want people to go in and see old movies in a museum. They want them to see new movies in a theater. So very few of the major studios care at all about their legacy. It's all about the next thing that's coming out, and the one after that, and the one that's out there now.
I guess until they can milk money from the legacy.
Well, still old films do well in DVD and Blu-ray. But when I say well, I mean up to a point.
Right.
Well enough. The Exorcist has done magnificently.
How many re-releases? Three or four? Theatrical
at least DVDs and Blu-rays. A new Blu-ray coming out next year for the 40th anniversary, 4K, which is so far the top of the line. Same with The French Connection. There have been many re-releases that more people have probably seen the film on DVD and Blu-ray, than saw it originally in theaters. And this is all over the world. They get these DVDs and Blu-rays everywhere. And old films around the world basically play in art houses or in universities.
Do you consume old films yourself?
I love, I have a whole series of films that I watch all the time. Often even once a year, about 20 or more films that are my personal favorites that I continue to watch and It's like listening to a piece of music. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like getting a CD of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony in various new and old incarnations. So I regard the films that I love like I regard certain classic performances of jazz and classical music.
Do you consume a lot of the current crop of cinema? Do you go to see?
No.
Just not that interested?
No. It's not for me. It's for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
It's for tens of millions of people. You know, some of these spandex movies, you know, where a guy flies around with a letter on his chest and he's got a cape and a mask and he, you know, cures all the evils of the world. I had my fill of that when I was reading comic books when I was 10 years old. And I'm not interested in it in cinema. I really don't care how well done it is. It's just not for me.
Mm-hmm.
It holds no surprise for me. I'm not saying they're bad movies. I don't know what they are. I just have no interest in seeing them. I have tried on occasion. And, you know, it's not as moving to me as the latest Michael Haneke film. You know, this Austrian director who's works a lot in France.
I think he's getting nominated this year also. I think this movie
he's a friend of
stunning.
Mine and he makes great films and you know not a lot of people see them. Probably more people in Europe see his films than in America. There was a film he made a few years ago called Caché that I watch over and over again and see different details every time I watch it.
Yeah, I think he's probably gonna have his biggest American success with Amour when it finally arrives, end of the year, it is the least complex, I guess. It feels the least complex, but it's so deeply emotional that I think you're going to have a huge audience for it.
He's a friend of mine, and we talked a lot about it when I was in Vienna, where he lives, directing an opera a few months ago. And he's just a lovely man.
Yeah.
And, you know, I certainly wish him all the success in the world, and he's a great filmmaker. He deserves it. He's the real deal to me.
So does 2010, 2011 affect how you shape Killer Joe in any way, or are you just looking directly at the material and directing the movie you might have directed 10 years earlier, 20 years earlier of this material?
I would have made the film exactly the same no matter when I made it. Possibly I might have made it better or worse, you know. And if I were to redo it in 10 years, hopefully it would be better. Because one of the things that happens to you as a director, if you keep working, is you gain a certain maturity. And you gain more confidence about the techniques of filmmaking than when you first started.
Mm-hmm.
So, but the stories that attracted me are basically the same, with the exception of like the first two films that I made, where I just made them to become a feature filmmaker. I'd come out of documentary. The first two films I made, I had no interest in the subject matter at all.
Mm-hmm.
After that, I did. But as I say, David, I've only made 16 films in 45 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a lot of work. It's enough for some people, I will say that. To a lot of people, they don't think it's too much at all. In fact, they do think it's too much, but not too little.
But you're still learning as a director?
Sure. Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's a process of continual development. If you know, I'm not comparing it to like the work of the great painters, but you can see the evolution of painting in the work of an artist who's worked for many years.
Mm-hmm.
You can see, for Vincent van Gogh only painted for 10 years of his life, the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see the evolution of what became the Van Gogh style from the paintings when he started in 1880 to when he finished 10 years later.
Hmm.
And he made, in that 10-year period, he made about 3,600 works, oils, watercolors, sketches, drawings. And in his lifetime, he couldn't sell one of them. And his brother, Theo was the art dealer for the Impressionists. Mm-hmm. And the Impressionists were selling, and they influenced Van Gogh. But he couldn't sell a Vincent, Theo. But you can, if you've seen so many of the Van Goghs as I have, you can mm-hmm. see his evolution as a painter. Mm-hmm. And it's strange because with filmmakers, you often do not. There are many filmmakers whose works I love. I'm going to take as one example mm-hmm. Orson Welles, who started at the top. Mm-hmm. There was no way he or anyone else could top Citizen Kane. Mm-hmm. You know? I'm not talking about some poll that comes right. out and says it's number one or two or seven yeah. or 50. I don't care about that. That's one of the greatest films ever made. Mm-hmm. Which one, I don't know or care. Right. But it's a masterpiece. Mm-hmm. Let's just put it that way. You know, what is a greater masterpiece, a Rembrandt or a Vermeer or a Raphael or right. a Rubens, you know, or a Caravaggio? Who knows? It's personal taste. Mm-hmm. But they're masterpieces. And Citizen Kane, there was only one way to go after that, and that was down. So he made a handful of very good films after Citizen Kane, mm. but they're not Citizen Kane. Mm. And I think to me, that's a fairly typical story. I don't see a great evolution of style or content mm-hmm. in most of the filmmakers. Like, there's a filmmaker whose work I love, a French filmmaker named Alain René. And in the 1950s and 60s, he made mm-hmm. films like Hiroshima Mon Amour and Last Year at Marienbad, which were trailblazing movies. Mm-hmm. You know, again, masterpieces, totally unique and original. Mm-hmm. And he's working today still. I think yeah. he's probably in his 90s. And he's still working. But I don't see any more Hiroshima Mon Amour right. or Last Year at Marienbad's. Same with Godard, who in 1960 made Breathless. And I haven't even seen.
Right.
He's been directing films now for 50 years. I think some of them after Breathless were just as good or right. better. A film like Weekend was great. Other people who know his work can name others. Mm-hmm. But I don't see, for the most part, that as filmmakers get older, their work continues to be exploratory or as impactful. I'm generalizing, of course.
Well, I think the U.S. system works against them in a way. That
well, I'm talking about foreign filmmakers,
right. Well, they have
Bertolucci.
Yeah, well.
You know, I absolutely love The Conformist mm-hmm. and Last Tango in Paris. But the last few films he made, I'm not as fond of.
Right.
This is not a comment about whether they're good or bad.
Right.
But when I first saw his work, you know, they struck me like lightning.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I just don't get the same impact from the later works of some of the masters.
Well, I think it's hard, I from my perspective, it's hard to, when a filmmaker becomes famous for this or that, they tend to be, either feel compelled personally, or they tend to start imitating themselves a little bit, there's repetition, and that's when I think it gets less interesting.
Well, Bertolucci didn't do that.
Well, but
he never made a film again like Last Tango in Paris.
But he's riffed off of that in the last few films in particular, where there's that, you know, the sexuality of it, the sensuality of it seems to be a theme that's recurred in the last few films to not as good an effect.
Well, Picasso,
effect.
You know, riffed off many of his styles for
yeah.
years.
Yeah.
You know, as did Rembrandt.
Yeah.
If you look at the great Rembrandt portraits, you can see the signature of the artist in
yeah.
all of them. Even though they're different people, different subjects, he's the greatest portrait painter I've ever seen, and living proof that you don't need 3D. You know, you don't need to see a Rembrandt portrait in 3D.
Mm.
Because the whole idea of the art of cinema or painting is the illusion of depth in a two-dimensional work, height and width. You look at a Vermeer landscape or even an interior, or you look at a Rembrandt portrait, you don't need to see the figure in 3D. You look at the figure and it's so powerful and profound and so beautifully referenced and achieved that you have the illusion that you're looking at a real person.
Though 3D can be interesting. I mean, it's very rarely
not to
interesting.
Me.
Well, did you see Pina, for instance? Pina, the Wim Wenders documentary about Pina Bausch?
No, I hear that's good.
I think it was beautiful.
I hear it's good, but the point
one in every 10 or 15 is worth.
I don't know that you need it.
Yeah.
I presumably, you know, the Pina would have been as good in 2D.
Well, he said he wouldn't have made it if it were in 2D.
That's fine, you know, but I don't think that 3D enhances story or performance, which are the two major components of a film, you know, the characters and the story. Or the performance by the actors. I don't think 3D enhances that at all. You know, I just don't.
It's interesting because I saw The Dark Knight Rises, the Chris Nolan movie, in 35 in a straight 35 print, and on the IMAX. And I think the IMAX work they did on that movie is beautiful and fascinating. And it's usually cityscapes, big images, but and then it goes back down to a regular frame through most of the movie. But seeing the 35, because of what he's shooting, to me felt more organic and natural and comfortable. But it was interesting that he had both tools to play with, and that you could have two very different experiences. I wasn't bothered by that so much.
I haven't seen them, so I really can't comment.
But the 3D
I don't believe that they're necessary to a visual art.
Yeah.
You know, the only time I think that 3D works is with sculpture, where you can walk around a Rodin, or you can walk around Michelangelo's David, you know? But I don't need to see a desk sticking out of the screen at me as the camera pans by.
You need somebody throw a spear at you at the
or
camera?
Or a guy throwing a spear, I don't think enhances the story.
No.
Not for me, it doesn't. In fact, it takes away. I think it's diminished storytelling on film in favor of gimmickry.
So do you think making a movie like Killer Joe at this point, is your growth as a director fewer strokes?
I have no idea.
Less
I mean, that's for
ornament.
Somebody else.
But I mean,
I can't evaluate my own films.
Would you feel, I mean...
Fairly.
Well, but you say you feel like you've grown as a director as you go.
No, I think I've understood and absorbed more. Have I grown? That's up to people other than me. Some would say yes, some would say no.
Because the casting is perfect.
Well, it's in the eye of the beholder, though, David, you know, at all times. 2, 3, 10, 1,000, 1,000,000, 10 million people can look at a film and have different reactions. I've seen some of the reviews of Killer Joe. And some of them say it's one of the greatest films of the year, and others say it's abominable, it's horrible, you know, it's dreadful.
Right.
And then I've seen the opposite of that. And I don't know what personally you can take from either extreme.
So do you take anything? Do you let it go?
No. I mean, what can I do? It's the film I made. Can I go back, you know, and paint over it? No, I have no interest. The film that I made was the best film I could make at the time. And if people like it, great. If they don't like it, I'm sorry. I don't feel good about it, but I haven't reached them. And it's not their fault.
Right.
You know, it really is not the fault of people who don't get some of the films I've made. It's the fact that I haven't communicated as well, perhaps, as I might have.
So is everybody meant to get everything? I mean, if people think that Killer Joe's an abomination are generally going to be, because they're offended, you know, saying it would be boring would be really a cutting comment on that movie, and I think almost impossible. But to say you hate that movie is really to say you hate the content, I think. No?
Could, yeah, that could be. And that's always going to happen. There are people like me who don't like Gone with the Wind, which is probably one of the most, two or three most popular films of all time. Mm-hmm. I've seen it. I don't need to see it again. I don't get much from it. Mm-hmm. I can imagine how people must have in its day. But I don't, Citizen Kane was made just a couple of years after Gone with the Wind, and I get, and it's in black and white, and I get much more from that than from Gone with the Wind. But that's, again, just personal. Mm-hmm. You know, if you ask 10 people, probably the majority of them will say Gone with the Wind is one of the best experiences they ever had in a cinema. Mm-hmm. And I would say Citizen Kane. And I don't know if you'd get 4 or 5 out of 10 with it. I don't know. I know that I've shown it to a lot of young people, and they haven't had the same reaction to it that I've
had.
Yeah. They're in a different zeitgeist today, David, you know?
Yeah.
And all of the experiments and all of the discoveries that were made and all of the great techniques that Kane synthesized for its time have all become part of the vocabulary now. So people are less surprised by the manner in which it was shot and edited and the multi-layers of the storytelling. They're less surprised by that than they were, let's say, in 1942.
Well, and a kid might say it's a cliche these days, that, you know, we've seen that gag, we've seen that joke.
Well, you know, or they don't relate. To I mean, Citizen Kane is one of the very few films that's really about something, that really illustrates some aspect of life. In fact, it puts you to mind of Christ's words to his disciples when he said, "What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world but lose his own soul?" Mm-hmm. And that's the question of Citizen Kane. It's an examination, in a way, intentional or not, of that very profound idea that Christ voiced to his disciples, the question that he asked of them. And ask it of yourself. What the hell good is it if you have all the money in the world and you've lost your soul? And that's what Citizen Kane makes you think about.
I guess this generation will be trying to figure out whether you actually, anybody knows that they've lost their soul. It seems to be like now we need to mask the loss of a soul as somehow a celebrity event that you're supposed to watch on television. And
I think you have a point that you know, there's very little concern about morality in our society. There's a lot of concern about judgment on people and on characters, and less concern about the flaws of the crooked timber of humanity, you know. Mm-hmm. And to a large extent, it's because organized religion has lost a lot of the moral standing that it had. Mm. We all, you know, we know about the hit that the Catholic Church has taken over the last 10 or so years. And other institutions, like Penn State being a good example, where the football program was placed above everything else at the school, including, crime.
Yeah. Well, as a card-carrying liberal, I still feel like the culture took a hit when Bill Clinton had to be excused for doing something that the, you know, particularly the feminist movement had said was completely verboten for 20 years. And all of a sudden, because our president was doing it, they had to kind of say, oh, it's okay, it's not so bad. And
well, that's probably the standards. The Democratic feminist movement. Clinton is a great example of, you know, the triumph of personality. It's hard for a lot of people to look at Clinton and pass judgment on him. And if you look back on the Clinton years, with the exception of his personal scandals, they were fairly successful years in this country compared to what followed.
Yeah.
And what is around today. You know, I think, in my view, America is in far worse shape today than it was under Clinton. And so it's, you know, what Clinton did in the privacy of his own bedroom or wherever the hell he may have done it, is really of no concern to me, other than insofar as he had a lie about it. But that all of the apologists say, very few people who, you know, commit adultery are going to tell the truth about it.
Yeah.
And I take a different view of what Clinton did, and that is, you know, it was human. He has human failings. He had faults. Nobody's perfect. You know, Abraham Lincoln was, to a great extent, hated in his time. Today, he's beloved. You know, he's one of the icons of America. But in his day, he was hated by vast numbers of people who didn't want to end slavery, didn't want to see the country broken up and go to war with itself over slavery.
Well, we still haven't really quite recalibrated since the internet and all of that kind of freedom of information has become such a standard, a basic standard. It's very hard. I think we're still trying to figure out what the rules are to match that amount of open information. I mean, obviously, Kennedy did the things Kennedy did, and it wasn't an issue. And FDR was in a wheelchair, for God's sake, and nobody knew, or very few people knew, and that was fine. And now we're in an era where, you know, literally every detail of every speech is being reamed over and repeated over and over on the internet. And it's a different universe that I don't know that we've all adjusted to. In terms of your films, I mean, it's funny because your films are seen as tough, harsh, sexual, violent, all those things, but your characters really do have a very, each character choice you make, they all have seem to have a very strong position. They've taken a, made a choice. Whatever side of the line they're on, they actually have their own morality. They actually seem to have their own sense of what is appropriate or not.
For them, yes.
Yes.
But
always firmly.
Killer Joe is one of a number of films I made where there really is no redemption.
No.
If people are going to see a film or to read a story or a book, a novel, to seek redemption in the characters, it's not there in Killer Joe. There are just some characters and some parts of human behavior that seem to me to be beyond redemption. And I'm not comparing Killer Joe, for example, to Hitler or the Nazis, but they were beyond redemption, period. That's it. I don't care if they were all Catholics and confessed their sins, which would entitle them to enter the kingdom of heaven. They, what they did and what other peoples have done, what are beyond redemption. And the characters in Killer Joe are more or less, there is no redemption, whether they're beyond it or not.
Which makes it more interesting for you, or?
No, it's just, it is what it is.
Is that what was interesting about it for you? I mean, what?
No, it's one of many, many things. The story is what's interesting to me. The story is not all that different from Double Indemnity, you know? The story is about an insurance scam, like Double Indemnity. It's about the things that people will do in terms of greed, you know, to escape their surroundings, escape the positions they find themselves in, the desperate measures they take to realize their dreams. And so in that sense, they're trapped by their dreams in a very disgusting reality.
And are you now done with the movie? The movie's out in theaters in the United States and across the world. Are you?
Hasn't opened in Europe.
Hasn't opened in Europe yet.
It opened in England. It's still playing in England. It's been about 6 weeks or so, but it opens in the rest of Europe in the fall.
Does your focus move along now? Are you? I know you're going on a trip, but are you, is your head on to the next thing?
Or definitely. Yeah, but I never give up any of my films, you know, in terms of, I just got an email today saying, when can I come in and do the voiceover for the home video? You know, and I can't do it till sometime in August. Mm-hmm. I have no idea now what I would say. I don't want to just sit there and describe the events in the movie. Mm-hmm. I will have to find a way of talking about the film in the way that we're talking about it. So it's not necessarily illustrative of any of the scenes that people are watching. Mm-hmm. I don't know why people want to watch or listen to a director doing a voice track of his film anyway. I've done it. Mm-hmm. For many of my films, I don't enjoy it, and I don't know why anyone would be interested in it. I'd rather watch the film.
Yeah. Well, I guess after we've seen some of these films so many times that it's another perspective.
Maybe for if they're well done, they have some value for students, film students, and historians, perhaps. Yeah.